Welcome to Steps to Life. Ask the beasts, and they will teach you. And the birds of the air, and they will tell you. Or speak to the earth, and it will teach you. And the fish of the sea will explain to you. Who among all these does not know that the hand of the Lord has done this?
How much is salvation worth to you? If it's worth enough, then you'll make enough of a commitment so that you'll receive it. Salvation is available right now to everybody in the world. But everybody's not going to receive it because they don't value it enough to make the commitment necessary to receive it. Before we look at this subject again, let's pray and ask the Lord to help us understand what we're going to study. Father in heaven, we earnestly pray that your Holy Spirit will open up to our minds, our understanding, the value of being saved. Help us to understand that it has an infinite value. Oh Lord, we pray that you'll help our minds, feeble as we are, to understand something about eternity and heaven and the desirableness of being found in that place and inheriting that place. Help us now, we pray, by your Spirit. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Heaven has a price, just like everything else that is worthwhile. And the price of heaven is Jesus. And it involves being saved, involves repentance, but it involves making a commitment. In fact, the word that's translated believe or faith in the New Testament is a word that means to make a commitment. Let me show you that in a text that we've read before, and you probably already know this text, but look in John, the second chapter, John, the second chapter, and verse 24. It says, but Jesus did not commit himself to them because he knew all men. Now that word that's translated commit, that's the same Greek word that we usually translate believe or have faith. The word that's translated believe or have faith, people say all you have to do to be saved is believe. And that's true if people know what the word believe means. The word believe, the Greek word pistis or pistos, which means faithful, it means to believe something enough so that you commit to it. That's what it means. And if you commit, there won't be a single person in the final day of judgment that will be able to say to the Lord, Lord, I committed everything to you, and now I'm lost. There won't be anybody that will be able to say that. If you commit, I'm here to tell you some really good news. Jesus Christ does not ever lose a case if you commit. If you commit yourself to him, he will not lose your case. He will save you. But what if you don't commit? Look in Matthew, the 10th chapter. Verses 32 and 33. It says, therefore, whoever confesses me before men, him I will also confess before my Father who is in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, him I will also deny before my Father who is in heaven. If you've made a commitment, you will confess him. You will confess Christ to the world. Because we have lived for so long in the Western countries like the United States, in a land where we have religious liberty, we do not understand as clearly sometimes what people that lived in other countries and other ages understood about making a commitment to Christ. I read recently again of the lady Felicitas. Now, Felicitas was a prominent Roman citizen who lived in the city of Rome in the middle of the second century. She had a husband, and she had seven sons, but then her husband died, so she was a widow. But she was a prominent Roman citizen, and she and her seven sons had a church in their own home. They were a church in their home. There were many home churches throughout the Roman Empire in those days. By her Christian conversation that she had with many Roman women in the city of Rome, many other women became Christians. In fact, so many women became Christians as a result of her testimony that it came to the eyes of the government authorities. They noticed what was going on. And not only were many women becoming Christians as a result of her testimony, but there were many men who became Christians as a result of the testimony of her seven sons, who were also Christians. So many people became Christians because of her testimony that the pagan priests complained to the governor. And so, an official of the Roman government by the name of Publius was sent to investigate this case and to see that these people gave up their Christian religion and sacrificed to the gods. But because Felicitas was such a highly respected woman, this Roman official, invited her and her sons secretly to his house. And he made to them many promises and entreaties. But he told them that if they were not willing to sacrifice to the Roman gods, like the rest of the populace, they would have to be punished. Well, this lady knew that Jesus had said, "Whoever confesses me before men, him will I also confess before my Father which is in heaven." And this is what she replied when he threatened her that she would be punished and her sons if she did not submit. She said, "I am neither moved by your flatteries and entreaties, nor am I intimidated by your threats. For I experience in my heart the working of the Holy Ghost, which gives me a living power and prepares me for the conflict of suffering to endure all that thou mayest lay upon me for the confession of my faith." And he said, "Well then, very well. If you are pleased to die for your faith, at least, as a mother, have compassion on your sons and allow them to sacrifice to the gods so that their lives may be spared." This is what she replied. "Your compassion is pure wickedness, and your admonition is nothing but cruelty. For if my sons should sacrifice to the gods, they would not ransom their lives, but sell them to the hellish fiend, whose slaves, yea, whose serfs in soul and body they would become, and be reserved by him in chains of darkness for everlasting fire." And then she turned away from Publius, and then she made the following plea to her seven sons. She said, "Remain steadfast in the faith and in the confession of Christ, for Christ and his saints are waiting for you. Behold, heaven is open before you. Therefore, fight valiantly for your souls and show that you are faithful in the love of Christ wherewith he loves you and you him." When she appealed to her sons to be faithful to Christ right in the presence of this heathen judge, he became so infuriated, he gave a commandment to one of the assistants to smite her on the cheek. And he said, "How do you dare thus impudently exhort your sons in my presence and make them obstinate to disobey the commands of the emperor, whereas it would be far more proper for thee to incite them to obedience toward him?" Well, she was not daunted by this. She turned to him and said this, "If you, O judge, did know our Savior Jesus Christ and the power of his Godhead and majesty, you would undoubtedly desist from persecuting the Christians and wouldst not seek to draw us away from the Christian religion by blaspheming his holy name. For whoever curses Christ and his faithful one curses God himself, who by faith dwells in their heart." When she said this, they struck her on the face to try and make her quit talking. But she would not. And she said she was willing to die for her faith in Jesus. And so Publius decided, he knew that he had lost the case with the mother, but he decided he would try to appeal to each one of the seven sons to save their lives. And so he talked to them, each one privately. But he was unable to persuade even one of the seven sons to renounce his faith. And so he said, "You are all going to be killed. You're going to be tortured to death. But," he said to the mother, "you are going to watch your seven sons killed. And then if you're not persuaded, then you will be killed too." So the oldest son was brought, and they scourged him to death right in front of his mother. After this, the next two oldest sons were brought, and they beat them with rods until they died. And then the fourth son was brought, and they took him up to a high place and cast him down, so he died from the fall. And then the fifth and the sixth and the seventh sons were beheaded in front of her. She still wouldn't give up. And then last of all, they beheaded her too. Now, friend, if you're faithful, you're going to see all these people one of these days. You're going to see Felicitas and her seven sons. Let me ask you this question. Would you feel, if she was telling you about her experience, would you say, "Well, you know, I, I tried to be a Christian, but I wasn't faithful because I was afraid my employer might be unhappy about it. I was afraid that somebody in my family might be unhappy if I didn't violate my conscience, and I wanted to keep the peace. Would you feel comfortable making a speech like that? As I have read the accounts of these people who were so committed to Christ that they would rather be tortured to death and die rather than to deny His name. And I realize one of these days you're going to see all these people again. If you're in heaven, you're going to be with them again. Are you living in a way so that you will be able to say, yes, I made the commitment, the same commitment you made. I committed my life to Christ to be faithful to Him, whether I lived or died, no matter what happened, I committed to be faithful to Him. That incident that I just described to you happened in about 160, around 165 A.D. That's just one experience of that we know of millions. There are millions of others that we don't know of people that made the commitment and would rather die than to deny Christ. We're living in the last days, we're living in a time when there are subtle temptations to worldliness. And the devil is trying in subtle ways. The devil knows that burning people to the stake or killing them off is not the most effectual way to destroy the Christian church, because they tried to do that for 250 years and it didn't work. The Christian church just grew and grew and grew and grew, and despite of the fact they were trying to kill them all off, Tertullian said to the Romans around 200 AD, he said, the blood of Christians is seed. And the more, when they would kill, they would kill a dozen, and it would seem like 50 more people would become Christians. And that was happening all over the world. And so the devil has changed his methods. And because we are facing something that is actually more dangerous than the threat of martyrdom, we're facing subtle temptations. We need to study the warnings in the Bible of how the devil is trying to trip us up and get us off track. So I want to study several warnings that are in the Bible on this subject, how the devil is trying to trip you up so that you will lose your soul. So if you have your Bible, let's turn first of all to Hebrews 12. Hebrews 12. It says here in verses 14 to 17, it says, pursue peace with all men and holiness, without which no one will see the Lord, looking diligently, lest anyone fall short of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up cause trouble, and by this many become defiled, lest there be any fornicator or profane person like Esau, who for one morsel of food sold his birthright. For you know that afterward, when he wanted to inherit the blessing, he was rejected, for he found no place for repentance, though he sought it diligently with tears. What was Esau's problem? What was Esau's problem? Ellen White describes in one sentence what his problem was in the book Patriarchs and Prophets, page 177. She says, Esau grew up loving self-gratification and centering all his interest in the present. Self-gratification. That was the great temptation to the children of Israel with idolatry. You see, the idolaters in Old Testament times, and it's still true today, here is their religion. They taught people that you could do as you pleased. You remember what the devil said to Eve in the Garden of Eden? If you eat this fruit, you'll be like God. So what's the difference between you and me and God? God can do whatever He pleases. You and I cannot do whatever we please. And so in the heathen religions, you could do whatever you pleased. Let's explain that. If it tasted good, you could eat it or drink it. If it felt good, you could do it. They had temple prostitutes in all the heathen temples. They had both male and female temple prostitutes. So if it tasted good, you could eat it or drink it. If it felt good, you could do it. You could do as you pleased. That was the heathen religion. That was Esau's problem. He was used to gratifying whatever his desires were, so that he was willing to sell his birthright for one meal. That was one of the most expensive meals ever described in the Bible. But he lost out. He lost eternal life because of his propensity and his to gratify himself, to indulge in self-gratification. That's the first warning we need to be aware of. Self-indulgence ruins many young people, ruins many people for heaven. Self-gratification. Now, Jesus attacked this philosophy when he was here. Notice how clearly he attacked it. In fact, he said, you can't do that if you want to follow me. Look what he said in Matthew 16. Matthew 16, verse 24. Then Jesus said to his disciples, if anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. Very first thing, if you want to follow Jesus, what's the first thing? You must not indulge in self-gratification. You must take up your cross. And so, a warning that's in the Bible. Many people, how many people? We don't know. Millions and millions of people in all ages and in our time are losing their souls because of their gratifying themselves, their indulgence in self-gratification. If we want to be in heaven, we have to learn to deny self. Jesus said, if anyone wants to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. The cross is an instrument of self-denial. That is number one. Number two, another warning in the Bible. Jesus said that in the last days, the time in which we're living, it would be just like it was in the days of Noah. You've read that in Matthew 24. Now, what was the problem in the days of Noah? Well, now we can read in Genesis, the sixth chapter, talks about some problems they had. They perverted the marriage relation. That talks about that. They had a problem where it says, every imagination of the thoughts of their hearts was only evil continually. And the earth was filled with violence. It talks about those things in Genesis 6. But how did the world get into a condition like that? I'm going to read it to you now. How the world got into a condition like that. This is something Ellen White wrote in 1891 in Manuscript 24. She says, the sin of the antediluvians, the people that lived before the flood, was in perverting that which in itself was lawful. So they took something that in and of itself, it was all right. It was not wrong, but they perverted it. They abused it. They overindulged in it. An easy example is food. You have to have food. But can you eat so much food that you damage your body? Well, sure. Or the other way around, could you fast so much that you damage your body? It's an interesting thing. We eat until we're gorged, and then we starve until we die. That's literally true. When I was in the graduate school, taking a clerkship at the School of Health, everyone had to have a research project, and so the research project that I selected was to do research on the subject of obesity. Now, obesity was a huge problem then. It's an even worse problem now. It was recognized then, and it's still recognized today, that obesity is more difficult to treat than alcoholism. One of the reasons it's more difficult to treat is with alcoholism, you can completely stop. But with obesity, you can't completely stop. You can't completely stop eating. It's been tried, though. It was during that time, that was back in the 60s and 70s, physicians decided that if you quit eating, you'll lose weight. So people decide they went on long-term fasts. The world, I don't know if it's changed or not, at that time, the world record for fasting was 382 days. That was the world record for fasting in the 70s. I read about a young woman who, she was very, very greatly obese, and she was desperate to lose weight. And so, she went on a fast, and she got her weight clear down to normal. She fasted for 30 weeks, that's 210 days, and she got her weight clear down to normal. The only trouble was, a few days after the fast, she started having heart irregularities. They took her to the hospital, and her heart quit, and they couldn't get it going again, and she died. So after she died, they said, we have to figure out what happened. Why did this young lady die? So they did a thorough autopsy. And since she's died of heart failure, they autopsied the heart muscle especially. They paid a special attention to that. And when they dissected the heart muscle and looked at the heart muscle under a microscope, do you know what they found out? Well, when you go on a complete fast, your body has to have protein to keep going. And so if the body doesn't have it anywhere else, the body will pull a protein from wherever it has to in your body so that it can keep, you can stay alive. And the body had pulled the protein out of her heart so that only about 35% of her heart muscle was left intact. The rest of the protein that had been in the heart muscle had been pulled out by the body to stay alive. Because of that case and a few other cases similar to that, total fasting ceased to be done by physicians. And by the time I was in school, they modified that and said, we'll put you on a modified protein fast. They gave people a little protein while they were fasting because they knew that if they fasted for a real long time without any protein, they'd die. So they started what they call protein modified fasting. So what is good can be perverted one way or the other, too much or not enough. She says that sin of the antediluvians was in perverting that which in itself was lawful. They corrupted God's gifts by using them to minister to their selfish desires. The indulgence of appetite and base passion made their imaginations altogether corrupt. The antediluvians were slaves of Satan, led and controlled by him. Notice, the devil had control of them. And how did he get control of them? They didn't realize how the devil got control of them. It was by taking things that of themselves were good and God-given and perverting them. They became slaves of Satan. See, that's a trick that the devil performs on people. They think they're just doing whatever they please. But in the process of just doing whatever they please, the devil gets control. The perversion of that which is in itself lawful. In other words, the principle of balance. There is such a Martin Luther fasted so severely when he was a monk that he said later, if I hadn't ceased to do it, I would have died. In fact, he suffered ill effects of health for the rest of his life because of his severe fasting. So, that which is good. Now, fasting is good, by the way. Ellen White says that there are some people that would get more, if they fasted 1 or 2 days a week, they would get more good than all the medicines that the physicians can give them. So fasting is good, but fasting can be evil if you pervert it, and eating can be evil if you overdo it. Perversion of that which is in itself lawful. The devil is constantly trying to get people to go to some kind of an extreme. And unfortunately, Ellen White says it's human nature to go to extremes. So we need to be aware of those things. Here's a third warning in the Bible. How the devil's trying to thwart you of your eternal inheritance. It's in 2 Peter, the second chapter, and verse 15. It says, they have forsaken the right way and gone astray, following the way of Balaam, the son of Beor, who loved the wages of unrighteousness. And then it says in verse 16, he was rebuked for his iniquity. A dumb donkey speaking with a man's voice restrained the madness of the prophet. What was Balaam's problem? It's very interesting what Ellen White says about Balaam. Did you know that she says Balaam just had one problem? Balaam was a prophet. He knew the Lord, and he was a worshiper and follower of the Lord. He knew the true God. But he had one problem that he never gained the control of, over, never overcame it. Remember what we said this morning? If there's one sin in your life that you don't overcome, what will eventually happen? It will overcome you. See, sin is a power, and you will either overcome it or it will overcome you. And it's that way with any sin. If you don't overcome it, it will overcome you. What was Balaam's one problem? What was it? Well, you just read it in 2 Peter 2:15. He had a problem with covetousness. Ellen White's very clear about that. Here's what she says. The sin of covetousness, which God ranks with idolatry, he did not resist and overcome. Satan obtained entire control of him through this one fault, which deteriorated his character and made him a time server. He called God his master, but he did not serve him. So Balaam just had one problem, just had one big problem, one sin that he didn't overcome. Now I use this as an illustration. So you look into your, now I'm not to judge you, you're not to judge me, but it's all right for us to judge ourselves. We're not to judge each other, but we can judge ourselves. And I need to ask myself, you need to ask yourself, I need to ask myself, is there a sin problem in my life that I am not overcoming? Now friend, every human being has at least one besetting sin. The Bible talks about besetting sins. And every person does not have the same besetting sin. Balaam's besetting sin was covetousness. And evidently, that's the only one he had, because she says, Ellen White says, through this one fault, just one, Satan got control of him. So I need to look at my life, and I need to say, well, now, is there a sin in my life that I am not overcoming? People have sins in their lives that go on for years. We have many people, several people, right here in the Wichita area, in the Hutchinson area, which we would like to baptize. They would like us to baptize them. There's more than just one or two, let me tell you. But we can't baptize them because there is a sin in their life that they're not overcoming. Now remember, this can go on. It's not for you or me to decide how long it can go on. That's God's business. It could go on for years. But remember this. If the sin in my life that I don't overcome, if I don't overcome it, what will eventually happen? It will overcome me. That's what we read. If there's a sin in my life that I'm not overcoming, what will eventually happen? Eventually it will overcome me. Did that happen to David? It did. He was in repenting for the and sorrowing over that for the rest of his life. I've met a number of people that have gotten into situations where they're repenting or sorrowing over for the rest of their life. With Balaam, he completely lost it. David repented and was saved. Balaam was not saved. Ellen White says that the characters of Balaam and Judas are very similar. So, is there a sin in my life that I'm not overcoming? Remember, if I choose to make a complete commitment to Jesus, has He promised to give me the victory over sin in my life? Has Jesus promised to do that? Yes, He has. Several places in the Bible you could read where He has promised to do that.
You could read it in Romans 6. You could read it again in Romans 8. You could read it in 1 John 3 and again in 1 John 5. Or in the words of Jesus in the Gospel of John chapter 8, Jesus has promised. And my dear friend, you can go to the Lord and claim the promise. Think oftentimes of the man that I visited in Texas one Sabbath afternoon. I've told you this before. I knew this man because we had done business. And I visited him in his home. His wife was present, and his wife was a Seventh-day Adventist. He was not. And he told me, he said, "I can't be a Seventh-day Adventist." "Oh, really? Why can you not be a Seventh-day Adventist?" He said, "Well, I'm a smoker, and I can't quit, so I can't be a Seventh-day Adventist." I think about situations like that, and I think about Felicitas. Remember Felicitas, the story I told you, the prominent Roman lady in Rome in the middle of the second century, who watched her seven sons be murdered right in front of her eyes, and then she was murdered at the end because she wouldn't give up her faith in Christ. And I think about somebody like that, and I think, now wait a minute. Someday you're going to meet all these people. Are you going to say to them, "Well, I couldn't follow the Lord because I couldn't quit smoking. I couldn't follow the Lord because I couldn't quit my bad habit with pornography. I couldn't follow the Lord because I couldn't quit overeating. I couldn't follow the Lord because I couldn't quit listening to the music I'm listening to." Are you going to say that to the people that were martyred for their faith and watched their children? Do you know the Waldenses? Now, I'm not here to tell horrid stories, but we need to face reality. You're going to meet all these people. In the resurrection, you're going to meet them all. The Waldenses, they used to do this to try to get them to... They would kill their sons, cut their sons' head off, and tie the sons' head around the fathers, and then drive the fathers to their death. You're going to tell those people in the resurrection, well, and by the way, those people could have saved their lives if they'd have just kneeled down in front of an image. You're going to tell those people, I couldn't follow the Lord at all. I couldn't overcome because I just couldn't quit smoking. I couldn't quit drinking. I couldn't quit doing this. I couldn't stop this. Are you going to tell that to those people? What would they say, by the way, if you told them that? They'd say, "Well, we had to make a choice too. We had to decide whether we were going to be killed or whether we were going to follow the Lord. We decided it'd be better to be killed." And friends, you, every one of us, if we're in heaven, we're going to meet all those people. What testimony are we going to give? Look in Revelation 3. Revelation 3, verse 21. It says, "To him who overcomes, I will grant to sit with me on my throne, as I also overcame and sat down with my Father on his throne." If you overcome, you're going to sit down with him on his throne. What is it that we are to overcome? Three things. Here's what we are to overcome. Look in Romans 8. Romans 8, verses 12 and 13. "Therefore, brethren, we are debtors not to the flesh to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live." Put with that Galatians 5 and verse 16 and 17. "I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusts against the Spirit,
and the spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary to one another, so that you do not do the things that you wish. So, there's a battle that goes on in the Christian's life. There are some people that have a theology that they teach that you just sort of sit and let the Lord do everything, but that's not the New Testament religion. Paul says there's a battle that takes place. And there's a battle that takes place between the flesh. Now, the flesh is a word describing the carnal or sinful nature. There's a battle between our sinful nature, which we have a natural bent to do evil. We all do. Some people have more of a bent to one evil than another, but we all are bent to do evil. And so there's a battle that takes place between the flesh and the spirit. And one is going to win. Who and what is winning in your life? Is the flesh winning in your life, or is the spirit winning in your life? And let me tell you, friends, just because the past is a certain way, your future does not need to be the way your past was. The flesh won for a while in David's life, but he repented. The flesh won for a while in the Apostle Paul's life, but he repented. One or the other is going to win. One or the other is going to be overcome. Look at Galatians 6:8. He who sows to his flesh will of the flesh reap corruption, but he who sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life. Jesus said, if you overcome, what do we ever have to overcome? First thing we have to overcome is the flesh. What's inside? That's why we're to be born again. The Spirit gives us a new heart, a new spirit, and the Spirit wars against the flesh. The Spirit must overcome. If the Spirit overcomes, this is what will happen. Look in Romans 8, verses 3 and 4. What the law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh, God did by sending His own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh. On account of sin, He condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. He goes on talking about this. He says in verse 7, the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, nor indeed can be. So then those that are in the flesh cannot please God. But if you're walking after the Spirit will give you the victory. You will be able to overcome the flesh. Now, when I was a teenager, I heard a minister give a number of sermons on this subject that we're looking at right now. And he illustrated it in a way that I've tried to be careful not to use the same illustration that he used, because I think it leaves a false impression. At least it left a false impression on me. He said, the flesh and the spirit, he used this illustration, is like if you had two dogs. And you're going to feed one or the other. The one that you feed is going to get stronger. The one that you don't feed, he said, will get weaker. That was his illustration. It's a very imperfect illustration, because I have worked with people for many years, and I can tell you that a person that is trying to feed the spiritual nature by Bible study and prayer and witnessing and following the Lord, and he's done that for years, that person still can have a battle with the flesh. But the flesh must be overcome. The Spirit must overcome the flesh if we're going to be saved. That's the first thing we overcome. What else must a Christian overcome? Look in 1 John 5. 1 John 5:4. Whatever is born of God overcomes the world, and this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Now, what is it that's in the world that a person has to overcome? Well, 1 John 2:16 says, all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. When we're talking about the flesh, we're talking about temptations that come from within. When we're talking about the world, we're talking about temptations that come from without. We must overcome not only the flesh, but the world. And there is a third thing that we are to overcome.
Look in Ephesians, the 6th chapter. Ephesians, the 6th chapter, verses 12 and 13. It says, "We do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand." We must overcome the devil. What's involved in overcoming the devil? How? May the Lord help me to make this plain and clear to you, because this affects even the children. After Adam and Eve sinned in the Garden of Eden, the devil has access to the human race 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. The devil has access to people's minds that they allow them, even when they're sitting in church. The devil is very busy while people are in church, by the way, trying to work on their mind. And what does the devil do? Let me tell you something. The devil has the ability to bring thoughts to your mind. You don't even know there's any evil angels around, but all of a sudden thoughts come into your mind. All the evil thoughts that come into your mind are not simply thoughts that just came from your own sinful nature. The devil has ability to, shall I say, inject evil thoughts to a person's mind. And when that happens, what's the devil's hope? The devil's hope is that you will cherish those evil thoughts. If you cherish them, he's just won a battle. And there are Christians, friends, where the devil has been bringing various evil imaginations to their mind, and they've been cherishing those things. They don't even know the devil's involved. They're just thinking about things. And the devil wins battle after battle after battle, day after day after day. And eventually, they come to the preacher, some of them, and they say, "I've got this a problem with my mind, and I can't stop doing this. I've done this for so long, I can't stop." Well, you can't stop unless the Holy Spirit sets you free. But that's what Jesus has promised to do. Remember, Jesus said, "He who commits sin is a what? Is a slave of sin." Why does the devil want to defile your mind with evil thoughts? Why? Evil thoughts, evil imaginations defile the mind, and he knows that if you become a victim of that, you will never be able to be in the kingdom of heaven. Because notice what it says in Revelation 21. It says in Revelation 21, 27, "There shall by no means enter it anything that defiles or causes an abomination or a lie, but only those who are written in the Lamb's Book of Life." If I am thinking, if I'm a victim of any evil thoughts, then I am defiled. You see, long before a person becomes defiled by what he says in his speech or what he does with his body, long before that, that person has become defiled in the mind. Ellen White's very clear on that. If you want to read about that, read the chapter about the problem the children of Israel had with adultery and fornication and worshiping idols just before they entered the Promised Land. It's in Patriarchs and Prophets. We've already read it in prayer meeting. The chapter entitled Apostasy at the Jordan, she says in there that a person doesn't go just instantly from purity to impurity. It doesn't happen. It happens over a long period of time. The devil's working on a person's mind. Jesus said, if you overcome, as long as the devil is around, we will have things to overcome. Ellen White says, as long as the devil is in existence, you and I will have besetments to overcome, because the devil will see to it that we have them. But Jesus wouldn't tell us that we could sit down with his throne if we overcame, if he did not have in mind to give us the power to overcome. You know, friend, God can help you no matter what your situation is. And God can give you the victory no matter what your situation is. If you can believe, if you can trust Him and make a commitment and say, Lord, here I am. Friend, God knows all about you. He knows all about, He knows every thought that you've ever thought since you were born. He has it all recorded. He knows every word you've spoken. And He knows everything you've done. And since He knows all of that, you see, what you've thought and what you've spoken and what you've done has formed habits in your mind. And these habits, as we studied this morning, those habits can become like chains of steel that bind you so that you cannot get free. But if you come to the Lord, even if you have been bound and you can't get free, the Bible says help is laid on somebody that's mighty. He can set you free. And you must be set free if you're going to be in the kingdom of heaven. One time, Ellen White wrote a letter to a man. And this man was living in sin. Now, I believe, if I remember correctly, that this man had a wife, but he had more than a wife. He had a mistress. And he had had this mistress for a very long time. And so Ellen White wrote some letters. She wrote a letter to his mistress, and she wrote a letter to this man. And she told him, she said, the sands of time have just about run out for you. What does that mean? That means you're not going to live in this world very much longer. And the condition you're now, you will be lost. But she told him, she said, if even though it's the 11th hour, if you will come to Jesus just the way you are, the Lord will set you free from this besetting sin that you have. Now, I don't know what happened to him. I don't know if he took up the Lord's offer to him or not. But I was happy to read that letter to find out that I'm a preacher. And I can offer salvation to somebody that's been bound in sin for many years, like that man, if they're willing to come to the Lord and say, Lord, I want to be set free from sin. The Lord can set you free. I want to close by reading to you a few wonderful promises having to do with the Ten Commandments. David said, he said, I love your law. I meditate on it all day. In another place, he said, the righteous man meditates on it day and night. The devil is telling people, even Christians in this world, that the law is something that's restrictive. Is the law restrictive? Let me read to you a few wonderful promises about the law. Here's one. Ellen White wrote this in 1896. The Ten Commandments, thou shalt and thou shalt not, are 10 promises assured to us if we render obedience to the law governing the universe. If ye love me, keep my commandments. Here is the sum and substance of the law of God. The terms of salvation for every son and daughter of Adam are here outlined. The 10 holy precepts spoken by Christ upon Sinai's Mount were the revelation of the character of God and made known to the world the fact that he had jurisdiction over the whole human heritage. That law of 10 precepts of the greatest love that can be presented to man is the voice of God from heaven speaking to the soul in promise. What's the promise? Here's the promise. This do, and you will not come under the dominion and control of Satan. What will happen to you if you keep the 10 commandments? You will not come under the dominion and control of Satan. There is not a negative in that law, although it may appear thus. It is do and live. She also wrote that the Ten Commandments are a wall of protection. She said, the Lord has given His holy commandments to be a wall of protection around His created beings and those who will keep themselves from the defilement of appetite and passion may become partakers of the divine nature. Their perceptions will be clear. They will know how to preserve every faculty in health so that it may be presented to God in service. The Lord can use them, for they understand the words of the great apostle, "I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service." The love of Jesus in the soul will banish all hatred, selfishness, and envy, for the law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. There is health in obedience to God's law. Oh, friend, it was the law of God that made the Jewish people different than all other peoples in the world. And it is the law of God that makes God's children different than the people in the world today. Jesus Christ is a living example of what a person is like who keeps perfectly the law of God. As we seek to copy Him, as we ask Him for strength, do you know there are heavenly agencies, angels that excel in strength, that are waiting, that are eager to give you the victory, whatever victory you need. They're waiting. They have all the power that you need. You just need to ask and then cooperate. Say, "Lord, I'm in this for real. I'm making a commitment. By your grace, I'm going to overcome. I want to be one of those that sits down with Christ in His throne." There are pleasures, friend, and joys awaiting the faithful that you have no idea, so far surpassing anything in this world, that if you should lose everything in this world, it'd be well worth it. The Bible's very clear about that. Are you going to be one of the ones that overcomes by the grace of God through the power of the Holy Spirit? The Spirit overcomes the flesh. You overcome the world because you're born of God, and you have the whole armor on, so you overcome the devil. Will you be one of those? You can be, even if you're the weakest. You can be. You can be one of those that overcome and inherit eternal life. Is it worth enough? It's worth enough if you think it through. Let's pray and ask the Lord to help us. Father in heaven, we thank you for the plan of salvation, that you have devised a way so that the person who is the weakest, the person who is the most sinful, the person who has the most sinful habits and is bound by chains of steel that cannot be broken, that you have laid help on one who is mighty, who can deliver us and set us free and give us power to overcome. And Lord, I pray for each one here. I pray that you will give us that power to overcome the flesh by the power of the Spirit. We pray that we might be born of you so that we might overcome the world, and we pray that we might have all the gospel armor on so that we may overcome every attack of the devil and the evil one. We pray for victory over every evil thought and every evil feeling and every evil word and action so that we might be among those that overcome and are ready to inherit that place where only the undefiled will be. We pray this in Jesus' name and for His sake. Amen.
Lift up your eyes on high and see who has created these things. Who brings out their host by number? He calls them all by name. By the greatness of His might and the strength of His power, not one is missing. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be above all the earth.